These are heady days for researchers working in brain science. New tools increasingly offer pathways to new understandings. Genetic mapping is one that's already helping to overturn long-standing assumptions. Ontario's capital city is a major player in this booming research sector. Here to tell us more, Dr. Tom Mikkelsen. He is a neurologist and president and scientific director at the Ontario Brain Institute. Great to welcome you to TVO.
Thanks, Steve.
I want to start by reading something that Carolyn Abraham wrote in the Globe and Mail almost a year ago, and here we go. Sheldon, if you'd bring this graphic up. The more genomes researchers study, the more evidence mounts that using DNA to predict health risks is anything but precise, for now at least. These days, nature's longest thread comes off like a trickster, shape-shifting from person to person, written in a wily language no one fully understands, with at least 3 billion ways to misread it. I presume that comes as troubling information to someone who does what you do for a living.
Oh, not necessarily. I think this is a new wave of how biomedical research is happening. We now have the parts list of the entire, you know, machinery of how the cells are built. It's complex, however. We had hoped that by sequencing the genome, we would get the simple answers, which would result in simple therapies and go ahead and cure. Turns out, of course, to be a lot more complicated than that.
Well, isn't that disturbing or troubling?
Oh, not at all. I mean, it's forward progress, but progress is never linear. It happens in fits and starts. And this is just a new wave of how we're defining how diseases function, even how normal cells function, and then the context of how they get disrupted and become these diseases.
Is this kind of divergence happening in other areas of medicine as well?
Oh, certainly, all over. I think the first lessons were from cancer, where, again, a naive thought that all we simply had to do is to sequence the DNA, identify the single, you know, spelling error in the DNA, identify a drug to fix that, and, you know, cure cancer. And again, it's a little more complicated
than that. It's a little more complicated. Well, let me just follow up one more time on this mismatch between the way the medical and scientific community understood brain disorders and then what the genetic data were telling you instead. Help us understand that mismatch better, if you will.
Certainly. I think the simplest explanation are diseases like Huntington's disease, for example. This is the result of a single misspell in all of those 3 billion letters, and that can result in the neurologic disorder that is Huntington's. Most disorders, however, do not have a single misspelling. The autism group, for example, which is, as everyone knows, a spectrum of disorders that are rather diverse, there are several hundred different genes that define that, and there is no single cause, no single gene, but patterns of genes and how they differ in the brain are rather difficult to analyze in folks where you can't sample the tissue like you can in cancer, so there are complexities.
I know it's progress, and I'm really not trying to be difficult here, but I am trying to imagine how you go to your supporters, your donors, governments, and say, everything that we told you 10 years ago about why we needed funding in order to do what we do, we weren't really quite right about that, and now we need you to continue funding for a completely different reason. Is that a problematic conversation?
No, I don't believe it's a completely different conversation. Again, progress is seldom linear. I think what it does do is open a whole new world of how we use these genes in the context of folks that are living with neurologic disorders. So, for example, one single individual is very difficult to diagnose, so we have to look at patterns. For example, the autism group of disorders is a very wide spectrum, and so the only way you can resolve that sort of miscellaneous heterogeneity or the mixture of clinical symptoms is in large populations and networks of you know, institutions and families and patients that cooperate together so we can further bring into focus how these different gene disorders and the patterns can be resolved into the symptoms that people are dealing with.
And for patients, are they disappointed with this development?
I don't think so. I think, in fact, they're seeing the progress happen. I think what we're wanting to do is to see how we can bring this new technology into sort of more routine care. But that comes from these networks and this innovation that lives inside the care delivery system. I don't think we can, you know, bring up the promise that we're going to cure it tomorrow, but we're certainly making progress.
One of the things that I have learned over the course of reading the research for this interview is that Toronto is a really important place in this world when it comes to brain research. I suppose I should have known that already, but it's really come home now. And here's a little piece from the Globe and Mail from science writer Ivan Semenyuk, who once wrote the following. Toronto does not have one single institution that acts as a focal point for its brain science. Instead, the local brain game is played in a range of hospital and academic labs. Many, though not all, are linked to the University of Toronto, which in North America ranks second, only to Harvard University, in publishing studies related to neuroscience and behavior. The distributed nature of the community means the city is not as well recognized for its neuroscience as it could be, but it also means there's a diversity and a liveliness to the brain research going on here that invites interesting collaborations and sets the stage for genuine discoveries. So just to be clear, Toronto ranks second only to Boston in terms of brain research centers?
So the Boston area, the San Francisco Bay Area, and Toronto are the triumvirate in North America.
Huh. How did we get there?
Oh, I think it's been many, many years of superb academic research. I think the later tendency, though, is to make sure that it comes out of the laboratory and finds its way into care delivery. The other thing is there's a burgeoning neurotechnology cluster of companies and the ability to help us bring innovation to the marketplace, and including into clinical care.
Well, you're a pretty good example of this, actually, if I may say. Where are you from originally?
I'm originally from Calgary.
And trained where?
Trained in Montreal.
And spent 25 years where?
In the U.S. In San Diego and in Michigan.
And now you're here.
Back in Toronto, that's right.
What brought you here?
Well, interestingly enough, I'm actually a cancer doctor. So the lessons from cancer, as I said, is where the first wave of molecular findings are finding their way into care. And after 25 years as a single investigator with my clinic and my laboratory, I had the opportunity to look to apply those lessons across neuroscience, which of course is the link between the cancer world and the neurology world. And I happen to bridge both of those worlds. So. Somebody thought it was a good idea.
Somebody thought it was a good idea. The Ontario Brain Institute's role in sort of bringing all of these different factions together,
yes.
What would you say it was?
So we're a government-funded not-for-profit, but we provide the glue that, in effect, coordinates and accelerates progress through this huge resource that we have, not just in Toronto, but elsewhere across Ontario, providing the infrastructure for these clinical networks that provide the contacts with the patients and the care pathways and the data that goes along with it to resolve where this genetic business finds its way into clinical care.
Is the Brain Institute, is it 10 years old yet?
Not quite.
Not quite 10, almost 10 years old. My recollection is Joe Rotman, who's the, you know, late great Joe Rotman, whose name is on so many buildings in this city because he's funded so many different things, basically had a meeting with Dalton McGuinty, the former premier, one day and said, we need this. I've got money. What are you going to do about it? Is that the bare bones of the story?
That's the bare bones of it, yes.
You want to fill in
some
of the blanks?
Well, I think the point is that there was an interest from the Ontario Innovation Trust to say, what other assets are under-recognized and need to be developed in Ontario? And a quick survey showed the expertise and the deep bench in neuroscience. But neuroscience with impact. It really was the key. And Don Stuss, who was at the Rotman Institute over there at Baycrest.
Been a guest on this program many
yes,
times.
Yes, exactly right. So he and Mr. Rotman put together this proposal, got buy-in from government, and launched. So right now, nominally, it's in five disease-related areas that are associated with common clinical platforms, common data standards, and intersections with other efforts nationally and internationally.
Well, that's key. Because it's called the Ontario Brain Institute, and in fact, probably much of it is in downtown Toronto, but as you say, it goes beyond that, doesn't it?
Oh, absolutely. There's islands of expertise in London, in Hamilton, in Toronto, in Ottawa, in Kingston, and in between. So we have satellites. We have 43 different institutions. One of the biggest tricks that Dr. Stuss was able to do was to have those institutions share data on the same platform. And so this idea of little provincial laboratories doing their own little work doesn't happen in the 21st century. Science is a team sport. Clinical medicine is also a team sport with the engagement of the academics, the laboratory scientists, but the physicians, the patients and their advocates, as well as industry. And this is the team that we're bringing together and trying to accelerate at the Ontario Brain Institute.
You collaborate, of course, but do you compete as well?
I think competition is actually friendly motive. So, it's basically competition with a goal to accelerate progress towards good end.
Here's another new acronym, at least new to me anyway, the POND Network. POND, Province of Ontario Neurodevelopmental Disorders Network. What is that?
Yes, so the POND Network is probably one of our quintessential programs where we take the best physicians around the entire province, their network of clinical colleagues, their patient advocates, and knit them together.
Is that them?
That's them.
It's a lot of them.
It is. They're a big, highly motivated network led by Dr. Anagnastu, who is a master clinician, scientist, patient advocate. She just hits on all cylinders.
And who will be coming on this program right after you.
Exactly right.
Okay. And how large is the scope of the project?
In round numbers, they are funded by our organization to the tune of about $2.5 million a year. They have five major facilities of expert centers around Ontario, again, sharing data on the same data platform, common standards. All the kids are evaluated exactly the same way. And interestingly enough, a lot of the tools that we use to evaluate these kids are the same tools used in other contexts in our other programs. So, for example, in epilepsy or in depression, so we can actually look at the intersection of those disorders. You know, in neurology, we have a tendency to collect a bunch of symptoms and then slap somebody's name on it. Alzheimer's disease would be a good example.
Sure.
But it's clear that most disorders are spectra. So they're not one disorder, they happen to be a very mixed bag. And our job is to try to use data in populations to try to resolve those into more discrete, you know, sort of categories. Kids that more look like more like one another rather than carrying the label of autism, which is a very non-specific label. Dr. Anna Gnasta will tell you that the diagnostic label, in fact, is not all that meaningful. But there are other ways of defining perhaps the causative mechanisms behind disease, and those would be more likely to be therapeutically targeted.
If you and I have this conversation in 10 years, are we going to be talking about Mikkelsen disease?
No, because we're going to stop putting people's names on it. We're going to be looking at the gene disorders or the pattern of gene disorders that drive specific flavors of these different disorders that today we put into a fairly broad category of autism. Same thing, for example, with dementia. There are many flavors of dementia. And in fact, pure Alzheimer's disease is relatively uncommon. Hmm. Usually there are some features of Parkinson-like symptoms. There are others that look more like a stroke-related disease, and very commonly, there are overlaps. And it's the same thing with the autism group of disorders. The actual label they carry doesn't necessarily provide as much value as we might hope. These aren't pure diseases at all.
Hmm. You used a word there that I have not heard used before to describe the range of different diseases. You said there are many different flavors.
Well, I think different patterns, different clusters of symptoms and things like this. I think to pretend that by simply naming a disease that we're defining a very discrete category is probably simplistic in these days.
Okay. Well, all right, if there's not going to be Mikkelsen disease 10 years from now when we have this interview again, what are we going to see 10 years from now? What are you hoping emerges from all of this?
I think one of the most important things we're going to be able to do is to resolve these complex groups of disorders into discrete categories that we can be very confident of how patients will relate to one another. They're going to look much more uniform and much less like a spectrum. Hmm. And by doing that, we can ideally identify what are the driving mechanisms of these disorders, identify specific therapies for them, and at the very least diagnose them as early as possible.
And if they're not going to be named after people like you, what are we going to call them?
Well, probably be named after the mechanism that's driving them.
For example?
Well, there are a number of disorders that are related to specific genes that are mutated, and they happen to be specifically related. Take Huntington's, for example. Huntington's is not anything to do with the Huntington physician who described it. It's one gene that does one job in the cell. So, in fact, you could name it after, and that gene, frankly, was called Huntington, which is now a protein that we know a lot about the mechanism of.
Okay. I look forward to doing this again in 10 years' time and seeing how much progress has been made.
Absolutely. Happy to take up that challenge.
That's Dr. Tom Mikkelsen from the Ontario Brain Institute. Thanks so much.
My pleasure.
The Agenda with Steve Bacon is brought to you by the Chartered Professional Accountants of Ontario, helping businesses stay on the right side of change with strategic thinking, insightful decisions, and business leadership. Are you on the right side of change? Ask an Ontario CPA.